about this, and those of you that have parents, you have older brothers and sisters, you know, depending on how this goes, the first Sunday, 7 o'clock service of May is when the kids are going to do their presentation, and I just assigned it by alphabetical order. This time I'm going to start with the Z's, so Z-Man Jr. starts first, and then we end up with the A's, and we go through the whole confirmation or the catechism, and you'll be doing that, okay? And what they're going to be doing is a presentation, and as parents, it'd be good to help them. The whole idea is, and I'm going to take them through the process, and that's going to be part of what we'll be doing on Monday, on mornings at school. We're going to finish up all of our New Testament survey and get that done, and we're also going to prepare the kids for their presentation. They'll each have about 2 minutes worth. It'll be memorized, but we're going to take them through the process. First, they're going to get familiar with that part of the catechism that they're responsible for, and then the point is they'll be doing a presentation in their own words and using contemporary things or life events, and in their own words, they're going to present their part of the catechism back to you, and we'll be working on that a little bit between now and then, okay? Any questions about that? How many of you have older brothers and sisters? Okay, quite a number of you. Yeah. Which means your parents have been through this before, so I'm going to have to try to find new ways to teach it, because especially guys like Neil, you can teach this class, I'm sure. How many times now?
What's this one?
Yeah.
Seven.
This is the last one.
We don't
have any
never
grandkids.
Say never.
Well,
Angie,
did you
have
an
announcement?
Not at all.
No announcement?
No.
She's just,
okay.
Sorry. Okay. So, you guys went through what a sacrament is, right? Can you finish up with that with Pastor Shoemaker? Because now we're moving into the three chief parts. One of them is what?
Baptism.
So we're into the sacraments, also baptism and what? Communion or Lord's Supper. And also we're going to do confession and absolution. So we've got one-third of the catechism yet to do in one-third of the... And we have half the catechism to do in one-third of the year. So. Always leaving late. Yeah. So let's do that. So now that you know what's a sacrament, you tell me what's a sacrament. What are the three points of a sacrament? That's part of it. Yeah. In other words, God joins His promise to a physical element, and we're going to talk about that today. Okay. That's one of them. Also, it has to be what? If it has to be a sacrament, it has to be what? Instituted by Jesus or God. And Jesus does institute both of them, right? Baptism, when was baptism instituted by Jesus? Not when he was baptized, although that has something to do with it. The Great Commission. Hopefully, a student will be answering these questions, right? All right. We'll get there. You gotta know it. All right. So, instituted baptism. Yeah, was what? 40 days after the resurrection, and Jesus says, "With the Great Commission, go ye therefore and what? Make disciples of all nations by baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything I've commanded you." So there is baptism, right? Instituted. What about Holy Communion? When was that instituted by Jesus? Right here. Who said Last Supper? Okay. And Passover, same thing. Because during the Passover, the Last Supper was instituted, right? In the context, and we'll get to that. So, When God took the elements of bread and wine and instituted a whole new covenant with the Holy Communion, we'll get to that too, okay? So it has to be instituted by God in order to be a sacrament. It also has to be where God joins his promise to a physical element, and we're going to talk about that today. And number three, in which he what? Gives us his forgiveness. It actually, it does something. It gives us forgiveness of sins and everlasting life. Okay? All right, so put your thinking caps on. And I want someone to bravely tell me, what is the Word of God? What is the Word of God? What is the Word of God?
Yes,
the Bible.
That's the first thing we think of, and you're right. The Word of God is the Bible. So I'm going to challenge you a little bit. You're absolutely right. And we believe that the Bible is inerrant, which means without what? Errors. Okay? So when you pick up the Bible and you read it, you have the Word of God. Okay? Is that where it started? Is that where you find the whole Word? I mean, in other words, did your Bible exist as it does throughout eternity? And the answer is?
No.
No. So what happened? How did your Bible come to be? Your Bible came to be where God wants to communicate His truth, His gospel, to you, right? So when you read a Bible, you're reading it in your language, and you're reading it in a language in which you what? Understand it, right? If there was, do you guys understand the Greek language? You know, the New Testament was first written in the Greek, right? So that was the original language. Koine Greek was the original language. But if I gave you a Koine Greek Bible, would you be able to read it? And would the Word of God be able to do something? And the answer is no, right? So the Word of God gets communicated to you through actual letters, okay? And for you, the translation of English is the best way to go, right? So you take that, you read it, and you have the inerrant Word of God. But where did the Word of God begin? Or did it ever begin? John chapter 1. John chapter 1. Gospel of John chapter 1. John says what? In the beginning was the Word. Logos. And then what does it say? And the Word was God, and what? Was with God, right? And then ultimately he says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Right. All right? So if you want to come to understand what the Word is, it doesn't originate with your Bible. It originates with who? God himself. So can you say that God is the Word of God and the Word of God is God? Well, John does say that, right? And he also says it's with God. The Word of God is with God, and he starts to begin to indicate actually the Holy Trinity. So, what you do then is go back to the beginning of the Bible, and it's very interesting. The beginning of John's Gospel is, in the beginning was the Word. Do you know what Bible he's trying to copy, in a sense, or really fulfill? In the beginning. Which one, huh?
Genesis.
Genesis. You go back to Genesis, and it sounds very familiar. What? In the beginning, what? God created the heavens and the earth, right? And then when you look at Genesis chapter 1 and you look at how Moses describes the creation of everything, the entire universe, everything that exists, he then begins to talk about how God does this. But in the beginning, God what? Said, and there was, right? He said, let there be light, and there was. He said, and there was. So, when God began all of creation with you in mind, he what? He being the Word, spoke the Word, and everything came into existence. And what came into existence? When you describe it.
Life.
It ends up being life, but what was the beginning? Was there life at the beginning of creation? what happens first? God creates, and here's the summary of it. God creates, and then all of a sudden there was substance. What substance? Material. He creates, and then what does he do? He takes the substance and he fashions it, and he creates, and you just go through the 6 days of creation, and you've got that happening, okay? So he creates, and he creates the atmosphere, he creates the planets, he creates the sun, he creates then the living things, which all come from what? The ground, interesting, plants, animals, human beings, all living things come from the ground, right? You go to Genesis chapter 2, and you have God fashioning Adam by taking the ground, making Adam, and then what does he do? He breathes life into him, and he becomes a human being. So everything you know has to do with the physical universe, doesn't it? So you and I can say God willed by his word to create a physical universe so that you can exist right now. And this is how it is. He created us physically, right? So when God acts, he does so. His word, he acts through material. And so it's not far-fetched in the end when we find that throughout the entire scripture, not only does God create, and then from creation, from material, he actually gives you life, right? He gives you life. He created Adam from the ground, Eve from Adam's rib, and then from that point forward, there was something called procreation, which is how every one of us is created, right? Starting with Adam and Eve, there's us. And every one of you, when you began your life, did you ever begin, have you ever existed without a body? Without material? No. Never. Because your beginning was when you were conceived in your mother's womb. And what happened? There was an egg, and there was a sperm. The two came together, and there's actually light actually happens. Do you know that? When we are conceived, scientists find out that there's actually light that happens. So every one of us is very interesting, very consistent with what the scripture says. Now science is saying the same thing. When your father's sperm and your mother's egg came together, there was a light, a little flash, and all of a sudden you have your own DNA. From that point forward, you have your own DNA, and nobody else has the same DNA you have. And at that point, you were physical and at the same time spiritual, so the beginning of you has to do with material. You started with a body. You never existed without a body. Of course, that body developed, right? But all the information, when you were conceived, all the information about everything that you are, this is science, but this is already confirmed in scripture, all the information about who you are, what you're going to look like, probably how you're going to die in some ways, you know, because of what we inherit from our parents. All of you exist now all of a sudden in that person, in that DNA. And it's who you are today as you've grown up, right? Isn't that interesting? And you grew in your mother's womb, you were born, and so on and so forth. So it's very interesting. There's something consistent about the scriptures where it says, when God speaks his word, in the beginning God created. In the beginning was always God, so his word is very much attached to who he is, right? So when he said, when he creates the universe, and he says, let there be light, was it the English language? I'm sure it wasn't. What was it? I don't know. Did it have a sound? I don't know. But here's the thing. God's word is God, all right? And God wants to communicate with you. How is he going to do that? Through his word. How does his word come to you? Well, the Bible then speaks of how he comes to you. Faith cometh by hearing the word of God, and that's where your Bible comes in, right? We open up the Bible, and God's inerrant word is there, and so we read it in our language. And because I can see and I've learned how to read, God communicates to me through the Bible. Okay? How else does he communicate to you? Very important. Through physical means. He's always done that. So you go into the Bible, what does God do? God creates everything. He creates a physical universe. He creates physical human beings. And then what does God do? You'll find throughout, from the very beginning, what does he do? He says, you can now commune with me, Adam, Eve. You can eat of all the trees, just not this one. But now you can actually what? Taste and see that the Lord is good. When that's said in the scripture, that has reference to, right? When you taste the pizza and you thank God for your pizza, it tastes good, right? That's all through physical taste buds, and God wants to bless you with the pizza. I'm trying to, this is very important for us to understand that God comes to us always through physical means. So from the very beginning, God created, he created us physically. What did he do? He creates man and woman. What do? They come together. And everything's physical, right? When I see you in the morning, why do we do this? There's something about that, isn't there? How are you? Right? It's physical. Sex is physical. Why would God create us so that that happens? Appropriation comes from that. Salvation also is physical. And we know that because John says, in the beginning was the Word, was God, and was with God, and the Word became what, everybody? Flesh, and dwelt among us. Now you have not only God creating everything by his Word, then the Word becomes the incarnate Jesus Christ, who does what? Saves us from our sins. See? So in the same way God creates us, from his power and his word, and he creates a physical universe, he also saves us. How? Through the God-man, Jesus, who is what? Physical. And why is there so much being talked about? Why is the very crux of Christianity about this God-man who physically what? Dies on the cross, right? And physically what? Rises from the dead. And how we get a little upset as Lutheran Christians when there are Christians who would say, no, it's just a spiritual resurrection of Jesus. It's not a spiritual resurrection. The entire Jesus, the Son of God, in human flesh, rose from the dead, and he appeared to them how? Physically. See how that works? So God willed a physical universe. God willed you to be physical, and God comes to you physically. And you can go through whole scriptures and find that out. Every time God, take the people of God when they're wandering around in the desert, the Exodus, right? How does God communicate with them? Through his word, through the prophets, through physical people who are prophets. Those things are written down and they read it in Hebrew or Aramaic, right? He also does what? Remember when they're out, let's just take when they were wandering in the desert. What does God tell them to do? In order for you to worship, you have to what? Build something. What did they build? The starts with a T.
Temple.
Ending up with a temple, but the first thing, you're right, you're on the right track. First one was the tabernacle, right? And why does God spend all this time in Scripture telling you how you're supposed to build the Ark of the Covenant or the tabernacle? And then you're supposed to build the tent of meetings, all this stuff. And what does he say? He says, when you build that, I will be there through the tabernacle. He's already talking about coming to us through physical means. And yes, then it's all about the temple. Why did David long to build the temple of God and he couldn't do it? But his son was going to do it. And so Solomon enabled, through Solomon, God enabled the temple. And what did that become? The center of worship for the Israelites. So they would physically go to the temple, and what would they do? Worship. And there would be, every aspect of their worship would have something physical. And in the temple, what they did was they took the tabernacle and they put it in a place called the Holy of Holies. They separated with a curtain, and God says, that's where I am. All right? That's how I'm going to communicate to you. See? And you can't go behind there because of your sin. But you will take what? A lamb, kill it, take the actual blood, and the high priest is going to go over there, and then he's going to pour that on the mercy seat of the temple, and it'll be for the forgiveness of sins. All of that, every aspect of that, is pointing to what? The fulfillment of the tabernacle and the temple. And so who is the fulfillment of the tabernacle and the temple? Jesus. So when Jesus comes around, he says, destroy this temple, and what? I will rebuild it in 3 days. While everybody's looking at the temple and saying, how can you do that? But they're still building it. It's taken decades to build it. They're still building it. Jesus is now talking about what? The fulfillment of it. Does this have to do with something physical? The answer is yes. Me. So, when we get to the sacraments of baptism and Holy Communion, understand that when Jesus institutes baptism and Holy Communion, it has the entire Old Testament, New Testament, the entire creation, everything that God does wrapped up in them. And all he is doing what he's always done. And now what he says is, okay, I'm going to take baptism, and I'm going to take the physical element of what? What's the physical element? Kids? Water. And what? My word, through the water, I what? The act of baptism, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We all got wet with that, and there was the forgiveness of sins. And God says, in that, you have what? Eternal life. And the bread and the wine. When you take, and we'll learn this down the road here, when you take the bread and the wine, and the words of institution, what does he say? This is my body, this is my blood. So that when you physically eat and physically drink of the cup, you are actually receiving the physical Christ, the incarnate Jesus Christ that John talks about. And therefore, you're receiving the very word of God in an element. See how that works? Isn't this cool? Okay? So with all that said, and when you understand it in that context, don't ever go back to thinking Holy Communion or baptism is just some kind of ceremony that we do, you know, on the sideline of God's word. It actually is the way God operates. Okay? So when you were baptized and when you take Holy Communion in a few months, that's actual salvation happening to you in those elements for you, because that's how God always acts. Any questions about that? Does it make sense? Tell me if it makes sense. Raise your hand if it makes sense. Tell me if you're confused. Raise your hand. Really? Nobody's confused. All right. So what we're going to study now is baptism. Okay? And you could take baptism, and dear friend, listen to me, you can go all the way back to the very beginning of creation. And you can draw the creation of God. God creates the whole world, and what was on the face of the deep? The whole world was what? Filled with? It was, what was on the outside?
Water.
If you look at the creation, there, the whole world was water. And what does God say? God, by his word, pulls the water back, and there was land. And then God creates us from the land. Then what happens during the flood? The whole world was water again. Why? For the judgment. See, and all that water, the Old Testament is already pointing to baptism. And Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 3, he makes that point. He connects baptism all the way to the very beginning. So we have the story of baptism. And this is why these things are written that, finish the sentence. You may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. So when God says, now baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you've got the flood, you've got creation, you've got the separation of the Red Sea so that the people of God can go through and that Pharaoh's army can be drowned because your sinful flesh is drowned, and what rises up is like the ark, is the new nature, who you are. You can go to the ceremonial washings of the Old Testament, where the priests had to wash in order to be clean, in order to be part of the worship service in the temple. Every aspect of that has to do with baptism. But the beauty is this, when Jesus says, after he's resurrected, and now he says to his disciples, go ye now therefore and what? Baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is the fulfillment of all of it. It doesn't get any better than that. This is now the fulfillment because it's attached to who? Jesus and the work of Jesus.
So that when you are baptized, it's the fulfillment of even creation itself. Isn't this beautiful? You guys remember what I taught you in the Old Testament? Say it louder. You got it. In the Old Testament, the concealed. In the New Testament, the Old Testament is revealed. What's revealed? In baptism, you're saved because of the work of Jesus, and it's yours, and it came to you. How? It starts with a P. P-H. Physical. Okay? All right. Let's take a look at our, let's go to our catechism first, okay? Go to page 285. Should we go around the room, or should we get people who would volunteer? Read. You guys know that the box card is what Luther wrote, right? Who would like to read the nature of baptism? Thank you.
What is baptism? Baptism is not just plain water, but it is the water included in God's command and combined with God's word. Which is that word of God? Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Okay. So baptism is from God, since our Lord Jesus instituted baptism, Matthew 28, joining water to God's word in the triune name. This is how God makes us his dear children. What does it mean to have a last name? When God places his name on us, in other words, the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, what does that mean? Matthew 3, next page. How are all three persons of the Trinity present and active in Jesus' baptism? How does his baptism help us to understand the work of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? It's because the Word of God was proclaimed with the water, I baptize you in the very name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Okay? All right. Go to a closer reading. What does the word baptize mean? Go ahead. Somebody else, go ahead and read that. The answer. Go ahead.
What does the word baptize typically means to wash with water, whether by
immersing,
pouring, or sprinkling. Christian baptism refers to washing with water in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, according to the institution of Christ.
Okay, so to baptize is to apply water and wash, right? So how many of you use water to wash dishes? All of us do. You use water to wash your body, don't you? That's the only way you can get anything clean is by water, right? That's how you clean things. Right? So isn't it very interesting that God would use, of course, water, very sustenance of life, in order to be the element by which you are baptized? Okay. So there's a possibility of somebody who will say, no, if you weren't immersed in water, it wasn't a true baptism. What would you say to that? True or false?
False.
So well, how would you answer that? Because they'll say the word baptism means to immerse, and it actually does, but that's not the totality of what baptism means, so that's not the point. The point of baptism is to wash, okay? So whether it was a couple of drops of water or you were dunked in a tank, as long as it was applied by water, you are what? Baptized, okay? 298, can somebody read that one, please?
What is different about the water with baptism? The water in itself is not different or holier than any other water, but because God's word and commanded are added to it, it is the divine water.
Good. So the water itself is what? Just, where do we get the water? you're right. You're right. You're about to say it.
Yeah.
From the? Yeah, that's where we get it. Yeah. I remember once, and forgive me, you've heard these stories over and over again, but I'll never forget the time. There was a young man about that high, and I was doing a private baptism for somebody, and I was getting prepared because it wasn't in the church service, and he came up to the water fountain, or the water, about the font, and he was gazing into the water. How many of you have ever watched Lord of the Rings? It looked like that. There's one scene in the Lord of the Rings where there's this water, and you can look into the water, and you can see the future and the past. So he had that kind of thought, like, this is holy water, right? So he creeped up to it, and he looks into it, and he's just staring at the water. And then I walked up to him, and I said, what do you see in that water? I don't know. That was kind of cruel, but what I was actually trying to teach him this, wasn't I? I don't want you to think that there's anything holy in the water itself. It's just plain water, right? The same water you take a shower with. Well, when you take a shower, you're not being baptized, right? You're being cleaned physically, but what? The point is what? The water attached to the Word, again, and you can't separate baptism from the Word of God. So when see right so no it does it could be water from wherever, but when the water is applied with the promise, I baptize you. And you know what baptism is all about. It's referenced throughout Scripture what it means. I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and forgiveness, eternal life. It's the Word of God attached to it. Okay. What if you were out in the desert and there's no water, and you were with somebody else? And while you're out in the desert and you are dying because there's no water, and you start telling your friend who isn't a Christian about Jesus, and you tell him about the promise of it and everything like that, and all of a sudden the guy goes, I believe in Jesus, and we're going to die out here. And then you ask the person, have you ever been baptized? And the person said, no. What would you do?
Baptize him with the sand.
Maybe, but I think there's even a better thing. What would you do? What? No, I think you're right. I would spit on his head.
Okay.
Take spit.
Sand.
You would what? I would take spit. The other thing you could do, but that would be gross. What's my point? Is there water in Europe? Yes, there is. Okay.